No pouring water, passing phones over, getting up to give me a tissue or any of this stuff. Wallahi, it really, really distracts me. So please, whoever needs to move, move now. Get comfortable, inshallah, so that we can have yani, as much benefit as possible. Also, before I start, I didn't fly almost 24 hours to insult you. So sometimes in my speech, wallahi, it's not intentional, I get carried away. It's not intentional. So some brothers, they tend to get a bit upset. That's not my intention, so... it's a disclaimer, as they say. Bismillah, alhamdulillah. Wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the King, the Master, the Sustainer, the Creator of the heavens and the earth, and we send peace and blessings upon His beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wallahi, my brothers, you will never know, my sisters, how blessed and how special you are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no gift, there is no blessing, there is no ni'mah that is more dearer and more valuable and more precious that Allah Azza wa Jal can give a human being than the ni'mah of Iman. And what a shame, what a crying shame. While yes, on our tongues we act and we say that no, we thank Allah, our actions really speak far louder than words. That Allah has blessed us and that Allah has given us the greatest gift that He could ever give any single individual. And yet we live a life. We live a life that shows no shukr to Allah for it. The ni'mah of Iman, my brothers and sisters. I swear by Allah that Allah can strip you of everything you have, every rand, every object that you own, every material. Allah can strip you of everything. Allah can take your sight, your hearing, your hands, your legs. Allah can leave you with nothing, but He left you with Iman. Wallahi, you are richer than the kings of this world. And the opposite is true. Allah can give you everything this world has to offer. My sisters, I really hope you're listening here tonight, that Allah Azza wa Jal can give you all the handbags in the world and all the shiny shoes that you could possibly wear. And my brother, you can drive the latest, shiniest, fastest, whatever car you possibly want. But Allah deprives you of La ilaha illallah. You are less than nothing. This kalima, La ilaha illallah, my brothers, you will never know the weight of it. I swear by Allah, you will never know its weight until you stand in front of Him on the day of resurrection. Then and only then would you know and understand and appreciate the gift that Allah Azza wa Jal gave us, my brothers. But unfortunately then it is too late to thank Him for it. We the Muslims are the chosen people of Allah Azza wa Jal. كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. Allah chose us from all the nations. Allah chose this ummah and made you the best. And today we walk with our heads down. When do we raise our heads? Please, my brothers, don't want to be recording, please. When do we raise our heads? When money comes my way. When do I raise my head? When I'm driving a shiny car. When do I... But the ni'mah of Iman, it goes unnoticed. Musa alayhi salam had a very unique relationship with Allah, very unique. He was the only prophet that spoke directly to Allah, no barriers in between, there was no Jibreel in between. So one day Musa alayhi salam, he says to Allah, he says, Ya Allah, give me a dua, give me a supplication, Give me something that I may remember you by, something that is special, something that is unique, Ya Allah. So Allah Azza wa Jalla in return, He says what to him? He says, Ya Musa, قُلْ لَا إِلَٰهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. So Musa says, you know, Ajib. He says, Ya Allah, I already say La ilaha illallah. And every prophet that came before me says La ilaha illallah. You know, it's not what I asked for, man. I wanted something unique. So Allah Azza wa Jalla in return says to Musa, He says to me, Ya Musa, if you placed the seven heavens and the earth and all that it contains on one end of the scale, and this kalima la ilaha illallah on the other end, this kalima la ilaha illallah would outweigh the seven heavens and the earths. And each and every one of you carries that in his heart. And instead of thanking Allah Azza wa Jal for it, all we seem to do is look at the things that Allah hasn't given us. The fact that Allah made you Muslim, without you choosing, without you begging, without you asking, without you having to draw a single drop of blood. You know this luxury and this honor that you have that came for free, my brothers. The Sahaba had to give their lives to earn it. To earn La ilaha illallah, they had to give up their families. They had to give up their lands. They had to go to jihad again and again. And never did they know if they were ever going to come back home. Their whole lives they had to sacrifice. And Allah Azza wa Jal gave it to you and I for free on a silver platter and no appreciation. This gift, my brothers and sisters, does not come for free. This gift, the shafa'ah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day of resurrection, does not come for free, my brothers and sisters. Allah didn't give you the kalima because, you know what, you happen to be South African, or you happen to be Indian, or you happen to be an Arab, or you happen to be good looking, or you happen to be from a particular family. La wallah, Allah chooses whom He wants, and He gives them this gift. But with it comes a great, great responsibility. Allah has rights, my brothers. Allah has rights. And if you don't fulfill those rights, and He's given you a big bounty, then for you and I, there's going to be the shock of our lives when we stand in front of Him. Allah created us, my brothers and sisters. Allah gave us everything we have. Allah gave us everything we own. Allah gave us blessings we see and that which we don't see. Allah gave me my life. Allah gave me my eyes. Allah gave me my nose, your ears, your legs, your wife, your children, your money, your house, your car, the lungs that you breathe with, the heart that beats. Allah gave you everything and He gave it to you for free. But Allah has rights. And Allah's rights, my brothers and my sisters, is that He is number one in your life. Let me get straight into it. The life that you and I are living, my brothers, you can fool yourself and tell yourself that, look, you know, I'm doing my part. But the truth is, what Allah really wants from us and what we are really doing are two very different worlds. Allah wants your life. Allah wants your heart. Allah wants your soul. Allah wants your fikr. Allah wants the best that you have to offer. Because He created you, that's His right. Allah wants to be number one in your life. Allah wants to be the most loved in your life. Allah wants to be the most feared in your life. But unfortunately, we love and we fear anyone and everyone except Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everyone in my life comes before Him. Please, my brothers, look, you can lie to other people, but don't lie to yourself. Allah wants to be number one. And Allah will test. Look at your life. Everything and anything comes before Him. What do we give Allah? Be honest. We give Allah scraps. We give Allah rubbish. We give Allah what we don't need. And anyone and everyone gets what's most precious to me. Allah has rights, my brothers. Allah did not create you so you can sit and play with your wife. Allah did not create you and I so we can sit and play with our friends and drive our fancy cars and build our fancy homes. Allah has rights. Allah wants to see what is more beloved to you, Him or dunya, Him or money, Him or your wife, Him or your husband, Him or your handbag, Him or your work, Him or your status, Him or your image. Allah wants to see. And every day Allah tests us. And forgive me, إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبِّي. Most of us, we are failing and failing miserably. ثَلَاثٌ مَنْ كُنَّ فِيهِ وَجَدَ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ. The Prophet of Allah says three things. If they are there, if they are present in a believer's heart, he will taste the sweetness of Iman. Something that we all complain about. Ramadan comes and Ramadan goes, no change. Salah comes and Salah goes, no change. The Imam can read Quran from Fatiha to Nas. Wallahi, not a drop will fall from your eyes. We give in charity, note, wallahi, no effect. We go to Hajj, I'll speak about myself. Hajj, wallahi, I stood on Arafah. I tried, I faked to make one drop. One tea come down, nothing. Allah has rights, and yakun Allah, what does it? Three things, he says, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if they are there, if they are present in your life, you will taste the sweetness of Iman. What do we all complain about? Sheikh, my heart is dead. Everywhere I go, wallahi, everywhere, Sheikh, I feel like my heart is dead. You want to know why your heart is dead? Because deep down, when push comes to shove, Allah's not number one in our lives. Please, my brother, stop recording. Record with your heart. Put the phone down. Allah has rights. And yakun Allah wa Rasul ahabba ilayhim mimma siwahima. Allah wants to be number one. Not number two, not equal, number one. Look at our lives. Look at your daily life. Look at your time. Look how we distribute it. Where is Allah? Rubbish, scraps. We give Him spare change. We give Allah spare change. And with this, look how dead. Not only do we give Allah rubbish and spare change, but with the trash that I give Allah, in return I want Him to give me Firdaus al-A'la too. And yakun Allah wa Rasul ahabba ilayhim. Allah wants to be the king of your heart. Allah wants to be the king of your decisions. Allah wants to be the king of your life because that's His right. Because He created you. You are nothing. You came from nothing. You had nothing. Anything that you have and anyone that you think you are came from Him. No one else. Your beginning was a piece of sperm. And before that you were actually nothing altogether. هل أتى على الإنسان حين من الدهر لم يكن شيئا مذكورا. Allah says, O son of Adam, O arrogant, ungrateful servant of mine, you, the one I gave you everything, and you don't even have time to just thank me for what I've given you. Sometimes a kafir, sometimes a disbeliever, maybe you're going through a hard time, he puts a few rands in your pockets and he says, "Here, there, my brother, you take that, you don't worry." You never forget his face. But Allah, the one that gave you everything you have and everything you own. لم يكن شيء. Allah says, O son of Adam, was there not a time you didn't even exist? Tell me. Today, my brother, you sit in your office. Today, because you jump in a 2018 model car. Today, because, you know, and we all like to act humble. Have you seen how we all act humble? Shukr to Allah, you know. But deep down in your hearts, you love it, bro. Allah says, wasn't there a time you were nothing? Who created you, man? From a piece of sperm, where were you then? Tell me, where were you then? O arrogant slave of Allah, O one who, everyone tells me, brother, wallahi, I want to do this, and wallahi, I want to do that, and wallahi, I wish I can be here, and I wish, and I wish, and I wish, and I wish. What's the number one excuse? Be honest, tell me, what? Sheikh, I'm busy. Busy with what, Habibi? Tell me, busy with what? Busy with what? You know what's killing this ummah, my brothers? It's not haram. We know what's haram. You know what's killing this ummah? Imam al-Ghazali says an amazing statement, and please, I really want you to open up your hearts. Imam al-Ghazali says an amazing, amazing statement. Imam al-Ghazali says, he says, haram is like poison. Even a small drop is enough to kill you. You with me or are you falling asleep? You with me? Haram is like poison. Even a small drop is enough to kill you. Imagine there was a barrel of water here, Zamzam, a barrel of Zamzam right here. And you seen with your own eyes, one drop of urine went into the barrel. Would you drink from it? What if I told you, but look, Habibi, Shara'an, you know, if it's more than 200 liters, it's okay. No, Habibi, don't tell me Shara'an or Shara'an, Habibi. I seen what went in there, man. A drop, a drop, a drop. Imam al-Ghazali, he says, haram is like poison. One drop is enough to kill you. But you know what? We all already agree. That's not the problem. Here's the juicy part. He says halal. Halal. Halal, he says, is like medicine. The right dosage is enough to cure you. But guess what? Too much of halal will also kill you too. Medicine, if you take the right dosage, it will cure your sickness. And you're back on your feet and you can continue. But even medicine, if you take too much of it, guess what it does? It also kills you. Do you know what's killing us, my brothers? It's not haram. Guess what it is? Halal. Halal. Because we're not doing anything haram, Sheikh, but I'm not doing anything haram. Yes, you're right, I understand. But the life that you and I are living, while yes, we're not doing anything in specifically haram, we have kept ourselves occupied with that which is halal, and it has taken us away from the very maqsad of our existence. It's taken us away from the purpose of our existence. Allah did not create us for the things that we're doing, even though they're halal, shara'an, they're not haram. Allah did not create us to build palaces. Allah did not create us to be buying and selling cars. And though, look, working and earning an honest living, there's nothing wrong with it. But my maqsad, the purpose, was not this. Allah says, I created you for my worship and my worship alone. To know me, to glorify me. There's two parts to your life, my brother. Whether this sits well with you or it doesn't sit well with you is none of my business. Fact is fact. Your job description on this earth is two things. Number one is to worship Allah. Number two is to establish deen on the earth of Allah Azza wa Jal. That's your job. anything and everything other than this is secondary issues. Whether you get married or not, Allah will not ask you. Whether you have children or not, Allah will not ask you. Whether you own your house or you rent your house, Allah will not ask you. Allah will not ask whether you're pretty, you're nice, you're sweet, you smell good, what brand, Chanel handbag. Allah will not ask you. What Allah will ask you about is, did you worship me and did you establish deen on this earth? And I swear by Allah, any and every excuse that's making you feel good will not work with him on the day of resurrection. I see some of you are businessmen, so let me give you this analogy. Let's say I'm a businessman, I own a factory. I'm a businessman, I own a factory. And I advertise that I need an employee, someone to work for me. So a young man, he comes into the factory, and he says, look, I've seen the sign outside, I'm ready to work. I tell him, fine, thank you. I tell him, look, here's my factory. I've owned it for years. I have a great successful business. It's running like a well-oiled machine. Please don't get involved. Your job, my son, is you see the empty boxes I have in Section A. It's a big factory, big warehouse. Can you see the boxes in Section A? He says, yes. I tell him, son, I need you to move them from Section A and I need you to put them in Section B. You understand? He says, yes. Is there any confusion? He says, no. Clearly, yes. Don't get involved with anything, huh? Don't get involved with anything. The boxes are there. All you have to do is move them from there to there. Agreed? Agreed. So the young man comes in on Monday morning, and as he walks into my factory, he looks at my garden and he says, what a horrible state this garden is in. He says, before I move the boxes, let me do some gardening work for the old man. So he spends the day doing my lawn and my grass and fixing my trees and my flowers. Then the next day on Tuesday, as he comes in, he's admiring his new garden that he worked so hard for. Then he looks at my driveway and he sees, you know what, this driveway could do with a jet blast, you know, with some water pressure cleaning, you know. It's mold, dirty. So he starts cleaning my driveway for me. And then when he walks into my factory, he realizes that the state of the toilets are pretty much inhumane. He says, what's this, man? You can't work in this condition. So he spends the day cleaning. He spends the whole week doing anything and everything except which I told him to do. So he comes to me on Friday afternoon. Says to me, boss, how are you doing? I tell me, I'm good, man. Boss, I worked hard this week. Boss, where's my pay, man? Man needs to eat. So I tell him, what did you do? Then I look at the boxes in Section A and I realize that not a single box has been moved. Then, son, what did you do all week, man? He says, my brother, look, I know I didn't move the boxes, but I did your garden, I cleaned your driveway, I cleaned your bathrooms, I did the kitchen, I did this, I did that, I did that. I was at work. I didn't cheat, I didn't lie. Check the camera, Sheikh. I was here at 7 and I didn't leave until 3. Exactly what you... I ask you by Allah, does he deserve a wage? Does he deserve a wage? Was I not clear as to why I employed him? Did I not clearly tell him, don't waste your time with anything else? Would you pay him, yes or no? Guess what? Every one of us is this young man when we stand in front of Allah on the Day of Judgment. Ya Allah, I did this and I did that and I went here and I went there and I built this and I did that. And guess what? None of it Allah wanted. Allah wants to be number one in your life. And yakun Allah wa rasuluhu ahabba ilayhim mimma siwa. Allah wants to be the king. Allah is always second best when I make decisions. We give Allah trash. And in return, we want Firdaus al-A'la. When we come to Salah, that's if you come to the masjid. Most of us, we're praying, this is if you pray, come in. If you pray, Allahu Akbar, you're a wali of Allah, come in. When we pray, what sort of prayer is it really? But when you're texting your girlfriend, what sort of attention is there, man? When you're texting your girl into late hours of the night, and you're eager and you're anxious for her reply, Allahu Akbar. Sheikh, she loves me, man. And I love her. We come to Salah. You know what your quality of Salah is. Let me not get into details. When we give our charity, my brothers, be honest, how do we give? Be honest, how do we give our charity? There's always a calculation process, isn't there? Calculation always. Sheikh, my rent for the month is this much. And then plus my groceries is this much. And my extra activities for the kids, like swimming and sports, is this much. And then plus I have to give her, Sheikh, you know, Allah says to look after your wife, you know. So the wife, you know, also she gets this much. Wallahi, such a calculation starts in your mind. You even include the cat that lives five houses down from you. Sheikh, didn't Abu Huraira love cats? You know, my neighbor's cat, you know, he comes. Sheikh, I need to feed it, you know. Subhanallah, I'm very soft when it comes to animals. Then after all of my calculation is done, then I look to see what's left over. Then from that, not this is what's left over, so I give it all. No, relax, man. Then from that, I decide what I will give Allah. Trash, rubbish, scraps, what I don't need, I give Allah. But my nafs, my ego, my wife, my children, I give bila hisab. Is that Allah number one in your life, my brother? Is it? Not only that, but even when I give Allah the scraps that I don't need, Sheikh, you know, I don't like to boast, but you know the masjid down the road? My family, they helped to build it, you know. We give Allah scraps, and deep down in our hearts, Allah owes me a favor, man. You go on a Umrah trip, you come back, and you're so content with yourself that you have yaqeen. Sheikh, if I don't go to Jannah, wallahi, I don't know who's going to be there, man. We give Allah nothing, and in return, we want everything. When you look at the Sahaba, my brothers and my sisters, they gave him their lives. And they always second-guess themselves that has Allah accepted my amal? Has Allah accepted my charity? Has Allah accepted me? Their whole life they gave. Look and read the seerah. Look and read the lives of the Sahaba. Look at the men whom Allah chose. They gave their lives. Anything and everything, if it came to Allah's pleasure, nothing was too much, nothing was too big. Anything to please Allah. Anything to make just to make Rasulullah smile. It was common language amongst the Sahaba. Fidaka abi wa ummi ya Rasulullah. That we will happily, happily, happily sacrifice our mothers and our fathers, O Prophet of Allah, just to see you smile. And on top of all of this, they always second guess themselves. That is Allah happy with me? Men whom Allah promised them Jannah multiple times. Allah promised them Jannah multiple times. Imagine, not your sheikh, not your father or your mother, not one of the... Imagine Rasulullah says, you are in Jannah. Not once. Some companions, 3 and 4 times. When he spoke to Abu Bakr, and just quickly, yani let me. When he spoke to Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, many times he promised him Jannah, many times. In fact, one time when he was sitting in front of the Sahaba, Habib Wallahi, where do you start? When the reconstruction happened of the masjid, there was doors. So many of the companions, their houses was, the door for their houses was stuck to the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when he did his renovation, he says, every door to my masjid is to be closed, except for the door of Abu Bakr, that remains open. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the Sahih Hadith, when he sat in front of the Sahaba and he said to them, he said, every one of you that did me a favor, every one of you that did me a favor, I paid back that favor in this dunya. Except for Abu Bakr, I physically cannot pay him back. Allah will pay him back on the Day of Judgment. Yet Abu Bakr says about himself, he says, I wish I was a leaf on a tree that an animal came, it bit that leaf, it chewed that leaf, swallowed that leaf, digested it, then defecated it on the floor. He says, I wish I was that. And not Abu Bakr, who has to stand in front of Allah and be held accountable for the life that I lived. And you and I, we're in cruise control, man. Sheikh, what else do you want me to do, bro? I pray my namaz, I give my charity. What else do you want, man? Always they were second guessing themselves, always. Many, many narrations when the companions would come, Ya Rasulullah, has Allah accepted us? Has Allah accepted my charity? They gave and they gave. But because they understood that Allah and His Prophet have to be first in their lives, not second, not equal. Allah doesn't want you to love your wife equal to Him. Understand, my brothers, when we say you need to love Allah and His Prophet more than, it's a question of iman. Because if you stand in front of Allah on the Day of Judgment and Allah sees that you loved Him or His Prophet equal to anything else, you have big problems. When Umar ibn al-Khattab came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he says to my Prophet of Allah, I swear by Allah, I love you more than everything in my life. I love you more than my kids, more than my family, more than my wealth, more than my property. I love you. Real love, not the lip service that we give, my brothers. Real talk. Not the lies that come out of our tongues. Not that I love Allah and His Prophet, but I never have time for Him. No, no, no. Real, real. So Rasulullah says to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Ya Umar, do you love me more than you love yourself? Look how real these men were. So Umar stops and he says to him, no, Ya Rasulullah. He says, then your iman is deficient, it's incomplete. My brothers and sisters, did you think you were just going to walk into Jannah? Is that what we think? Do you think you and I are going to live the life that we're currently living? And just before we die, we're going to make some dua, and we're going to walk straight into Jannah? So Umar ibn al-Khattab, he stops gives it some serious thought. He says, "O Prophet of Allah, now I love you more than my belongings and more than myself." He says, "So now, O Ya Umar, now your iman is complete. More than, not equal, more than." My brothers and sisters, be honest. What is it that we're so convinced of? Why are we in cruise control? Why? Who lied to you? Who lied to you and I and promised us that there's a Jannah for us waiting based on the life that we're living? So some of you might tell me, but brother, Allah is the most merciful, the most compassionate, bro. Allah is Ghafur Rahim. Allah's mercy is infinite. Allahu Akbar. Allah says in the Quran, وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. Please, Shaykh, you know, whenever you read those verses, you know, Allah, I get a shiva down my spine. Allah. Tell me something. Abu Bakr didn't know that verse. Umar ibn al-Khattab, he didn't know that verse. They didn't know the hadith. Why were they worried and scared? And you and I were not worried and scared. Why? Look, there's one or two things. One of two. Either they misunderstood deen, and you and I were awliya of Allah, and we, subhanAllah, we understood. Or they understood, and boy, did we get it wrong. Can't be both. You can't have two people, one is scared and one isn't, and told me, look, they're both the same.